Hi, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Camp, and welcome to another video in this series, Advanced Development for Grasshopper. In this video, I would like to talk a little bit about this thing called RhinoCommon, which is the geometry kernel that is fueling all the geometrical power that we're going to harness when scripting and when developing our own components inside of the Grasshopper and Rhino environment, all right? And why is that? Well, if you think about the examples that we have done previously in this series, you are probably acquainted already with the idea of the C# scripting component as a place where you can write your own C# programs and they can be executed in relation to the Grasshopper environment. And the programs that we have done so far look something like this. We can work with double numbers, we can operate with strings, we can do basic arithmetic, and all of that is great. And it's great because it's part of what the vanilla C# framework allows you to do. So C# is a programming language that has these primitive data types, numbers, strings, booleans, things that are common to every single place where you can write C# code. However, the problem is that C# itself as a programming language was not designed for doing geometrical manipulations of any kind. And therefore, C# itself as a programming language comes with no capabilities for doing any kind of geometrical operations whatsoever. The most fundamental types available in C# are numbers, booleans, strings, and a little more than that, but there's no vectors, there's no points, there's nothing like that. So where does all that goodness come from? Well, if you take a look at Grasshopper and if we go back to the primitives tab, you can see that there's this category called primitives, which has these four types at the beginning, Boolean, number, integer, and text, which kind of corresponds with the primitives that are available in C#. Boolean, integers, doubles or float numbers, and strings. They just have slightly different names. So there is a very close one-to-one correspondence between native C# types and the way Grasshopper treats them. But all of this, the rest, colors, domain, domain square, and especially all the types that are available as part of the geometry category, points, vectors, circles, boxes, meshes, surfaces, B-reps, curves, you name it, all of this, again, they don't come with C# out of the box. If we want to be able to use curves, points, and vectors when writing computer code, we need to have something else added on top of our baseline C# programming language that gives us all of those additional capacities. Think of it as additional features, or just like in Grasshopper, we can have plugins that give us extra functionality. Programming languages like C# can also have plugins that give them extra functionality. Those plugins are typically called libraries, code libraries. And in terms of C#, they come in the form of DLL files that we can load and that give us all this additional functionality. In the Rhino and Grasshopper environment, that functionality, that additional functionality and all the geometry types and all the geometry goodness comes from this additional library of code that is available in this environment and that is called RhinoCommon. RhinoCommon is a really powerful library that comes with a lot of tools for drawing things in the screen in Rhino, manipulating buttons, and then things that have to do with Rhino as a software, but on top of it, they come with a specific section for geometry that has all the goodness that we will be interested in this series. So where is RhinoCommon, or where can I learn more about RhinoCommon? Well, first of all, the developers of Rhino, so McNeil, gives us a documentation that allows us to parse through what is available in RhinoCommon. So for example, if you go to this link, which I will post somewhere on the description, or maybe it's going to show up as a card here over in the video. If we go to this link, you can see that this thing called the RhinoCommon API, the application programming interface, is basically a documentation file that tells us everything that is available in RhinoCommon. How this gets loaded and why this is available as part of Rhino, whatever, this is a bit more of an advanced topic, but we will see some details about that in further videos down the road. But for the time being, I'm more interested in understanding what RhinoCommon is and what has available, and giving you the tools to further do research on how to learn about RhinoCommon. So Rhino have a lot of, the library has a lot of namespaces, which is basically folders, if you will, or categories where certain functionality, classes, functions, etc., are distributed. For the case of this course, we will be mostly interested in the Rhino.geometry namespace, which will be the namespace that will have all the classes for geometry types that we will be interested in. I'm going to fold this to three categories, and I'm going to show how the geometry namespace basically has three categories: enums, structures, and classes. In previous videos or in my Learning C# series, I have talked about the differences between classes and structures. They're really, really similar. The only difference is that there's a little bit of how values are passed by reference, etc., that differs between them. But in very, very general terms, with a lot of exceptions, you can think of structures as useful for representing simpler data types, and you can think of classes as useful for representing more complex data types, all right? We will talk a little bit of how they work differently in a second. So if I unfold structures, for example, you can see that there is a lot of types that are available to me, like, for example, arc, circle, there's cone, there's an ellipse, there's a plane, which we will use extensively here, there's point 3D, which stands for point with three doubles, so a lot of precision, as opposed to point 3F, which stands for point with three floats, which has less precision. We have quaternions, scary quaternions. We have vector 3D, also three doubles, and vector 3F, three floats, all right? And we will be using many of these a lot. Why these are structs? Well, again, that doesn't really matter for us a lot right now. It's just because they're simpler data types. Points are very simple because they can be represented with three numbers. Same goes for vectors. Circles are also pretty straightforward, a center and radius. Planes are basically a center and two axes, you know, so they're pretty straightforward numerical types. And because we also typically work with a lot of them together, that's why we typically represent them with structures. Anyway, this is not our choice. This is how the library has been designed. But I will talk about more of that in a second. And then we also have classes. Classes represent more complex geometry types. For example, you can see here that we have Bezier curves, we have B-reps, and B-reps are really complex. They have a lot of information, etc. We have curves generically, we have the geometry base, which is the base type that all geometry objects inherit from. We have a lot of like mass properties, we have meshes, and meshes are like really complex structures as well. We have nerve surfaces, we have polycurves, we have polylines, I believe is part of it. I think that there's a lot of them. So why is this important? This is important. Being able to have access to this documentation and to understand how it works is important because it will give us the entry point to understanding what is the kind of things that we can do and the kind of geometry that we can model inside of Rhino. So for example, if I go to the point 3D class, sorry, struct, and then I open it, you can see that it tells me, well, it represents coordinates in three-dimensional space. The constructors are, I can create it in five different ways, from other points or from three coordinates. And if I want to know more, I can just click on it and see, you see, this is a constructor that initializes a new point defining X, Y, and Z coordinates. This is the constructor, and this is the three inputs. And sometimes you actually get tiny examples, for example, in C#, in Visual Basic, as we saw before, or even in Python sometimes, especially for the simpler classes. Now, for example, Also, inside of Point3D, I can see that Point3D has a set of properties. So for example, we can get the XYZ values of a point. We can say whether if it's valid or not, or for example, we can do operations. So points, the Point3D struct has methods. Like for example, I can add two points together. I can compare points. I can calculate the distance of one point to another. I can multiply two points together. I can multiply a point by a scalar, etc., etc. All right. This is very important. And then we can always click on each one of them and see like, oh, I can add two points together. And this happens to be a static method, which we will take a look at very soon what that means. Or for example, I can go to the vector tab and I can say vector 3D. I can create vector 3D from another point or from another vector or for three components. And I can find the length of the component. I can find the X, Y, and Z coordinates. I can find whether if it's a zero vector, whether if it's an unit vector, those are properties of the vector struct, right? I can also add two vectors. I can also check if two vectors are orthogonal, if they form 90 degrees between them. I can compare a vector to the other. I can calculate the cross product of two vectors. I can check whether if two vectors are parallel, etc. So I can see all the information. I can unitize vectors, and we will be using this a lot in this series. So there's a lot of information that I can learn from taking a look at this documentation. Similarly, for classes, I can take a look at more complex classes and see what functionality is available for them. So for example, if I were to take a look at the nerves curve, the nerves curve, I can see that the nerves curve class has a lot of information. So for example, I can create a nerves curve from another one. I can create from some control points. Nerves curves, I can take the degree of the curve. I can take the domain of the curve. I can ask whether if it's close. And you can see that if I click here, it will tell me that the result of this is a Boolean, right? So I can read that from the documentation. Whether if it's periodic, which is the same as whether if it's closed. And then I can fetch the point at the beginning, and then you can see that the point start property gives me a Point3D object in return. We will see examples of all of this very soon, all right? I can find the tangent at the beginning or the end, or I can use methods, I can use functionality to find additional properties. So for example, I can find what is the closest point to this particular nerves curve, and I can give it a reference point, and I can use a double to express the tolerance, I believe, or the maximum distance, right? If I don't know what this double property is, I can just click and see. You can see the double is the parameter of the local closest point, all right? And I can see that it's the way it works is that it needs an out parameter, which is also something that we will see very soon, as soon as we start taking a look at how to use all these methods, all right? For example, I can find a point at a particular point. So for example, I can say, where is this? I can find a point at a particular parameter along the curve. I can find a point at a particular length, which remember is different from the parameter of a nerves curve. And there's many other things that I can do. All right. So what my point here is that what I would like you to understand is that there is this core geometry kernel that is called the RhinoCommon API that contains this particular section called the Rhino Geometry, which has all the goodies and all the nice geometry stuff that we will be using consistently for modeling in three dimensions and for writing our own scripts and our own plugins. All right. And the way to learn more about how things work and what possibilities do we have is by checking the documentation, finding the types that we're interested in. I want to create a Bezier curve. So let me just Google Bezier curves. Oh, interesting. So there's a particular class. It's called the Bezier curve. I can create from a bunch of points. I have the dimension, whether if it's valid, I have like a set of other properties, so I can learn a lot from reading this documentation. So this documentation will be the cornerstone for our learning of how to interpret and how to use the classes that exist in RhinoCommon. Okay. Before we go, I would like to point you to additional resources if you want to learn more about learning and interpreting the RhinoCommon documentation. We're going to do that. We're going to do this in a few videos down the road, but in my series of in the lectures of my course at Harvard University, I have a few. There's a lot of lectures about geometry data types, but there are two specific lectures where I talk extensively about RhinoCommon, how it what it means, and how to read the types and how to read the documentation. So if you want to learn more about that, you're more than welcome to check these two videos, to which I will also link in the description of this video. All right, beautiful. So with that, let's actually now try to use geometry types inside of Grasshopper. So in the next video, I'm going to start creating C# script components that instead of just using numbers and strings, are going to start using geometry types and spitting out three-dimensional objects, okay? That's going to be super exciting. Join me on the next video. And in the meantime, if you like what you're seeing so far, perhaps consider liking this video or subscribing to the channel or even hitting the bell icon and turning on notifications to know when we go live, okay? All right, see you on the next video where we're going to do some scripting with three-dimensional geometry.